Welcome to This Week in South Carolina. I'm Gavin Jackson. Memorial Day weekend is the official start of summer, and South Carolina Parks and Recreation and Tourism Director Duane Parrish joins us to talk about the latest tourism numbers and what we can expect for the rest of the summer. But first, Gibbs Knotts, Dean of the School of Humanities and Social Sciences at the College of Charleston, breaks down the latest in the First Congressional race and what we can expect as we get closer to Election Day. Gibbs, thanks for joining us.
Gavin, it's so great to be here.
So Gibbs, let's start with the big news this week, and we're talking about the first congressional district debate that happened down at Burke High School in Charleston. You were part of the panel that was questioning Nancy Mace, Katie Arrington, and Lynn Piper Loomis, who got the first question in that debate and then proceeded to endorse Katie Arrington right there on the spot, took her microphone off, walked off the stage. What did you think about that moment? It was kind of the big highlight from that debate.
Yeah, I had no prior knowledge that was going to happen. So that really took me and the other folks on stage by surprise. First off, the audience was going crazy. There's a lot of Arrington supporters, real vocal. It was like a mini Trump rally, Gavin, in a lot of ways. And then after sort of it settled, I started to panic because we had 15 questions, which would have been more than enough for three people. But then when you only have two people and they still have the same amount of time to respond, I was having trouble even listening to the responses of the candidates because I was scribbling questions down really quick and we were exchanging them with the other panelists. But we survived. We added a couple questions. But I've never seen that before. And it was, probably going to be the only debate. So really kind of the biggest venue for Lynn's to sort of do that and make the Arrington endorsement, but definitely took us by surprise and seemed to take Nancy Mace by surprise. Not sure as much about Katie Arrington, whether she knew or not, but it was made for a very interesting start to the debate.
Yeah, having been a debate moderator myself and been on those debate stages, I can only imagine how nerve-wracking that would have been because you are trying to juggle time, you're making sure everyone's in line, and then all of a sudden you're a person down.
That's right. Well, the question we added was, one of the ones was, why do you think you're the best person to beat Annie Andrews? Because she's the likely Democratic. She's the only person running on the Democratic side. The next question we had in the queue was, what's Joe Biden's biggest mistake? And given the tenor of that debate, that would have been a fun question. We didn't get to it. Mm-hmm. But you could see, those two candidates would have probably gone on for a really long time, exceeded time, explaining what they are frustrated about with Joe Biden. And so that was the next thing. But it was a really interesting debate.
And Gibbs, talking about that endorsement from Linz, she's still on the ballot, so she can still kind of maybe even affect this election in some way, since any candidate who's in this primary battle, you have to have 50% plus one vote. So this could, sway things and probably lead to a runoff. We'll see. We don't really have too much polling on this race. But do you think that was an effective way to endorse her? I mean, it seems like it was a really quick thing and then it was kind of done. Anything you can kind of gauge from that?
I think it got the most attention that she probably could have gotten, saying, had she just done a press conference, at the base of the Ravenel Bridge or something like that. But I don't think, when you look at the amount of money she's raised and her name recognition, I don't think it really was always a race between Mace and Arrington. And so, I don't think there are a lot of Lynn's supporters that are going to come over and be with Arrington. But it did make for some high drama and fireworks. But I still think she's probably, even though she's going to be on the ballot, I don't expect her to get a lot of votes.
Mm-hmm. And when we look at the rest of the debate, what were some big takeaways there? What were some of the big jabs that you thought landed from either Arrington or Mace?
Yeah, I mean, Arrington, could have been on, a nightly Fox News show or at a Trump rally. So, she talked about everything from whether pigs should give birth standing up or laying down, criticizing Mace on some government funding that I think she must have voted for at some point or allegedly voted for or something like that. Just a lot of, to me, the question that really stuck with me is we asked something about, are you willing to work with the other side, even when it means you're not going to get everything you want as a Republican? And Mace is like, absolutely. That's her bread and butter. She sort of feels like, I'm in a district that's a little bit of a swing district. I have to be able to work with Democrats when it's best for South Carolina. Arrington, completely different. She's like, the Democrats are unhinged. We can't work with them. This is, basically we have to sort of, we can't compromise. And so that really, to me, sort of showed the biggest differences between the two. Mace has a conservative voting record. She's endorsed some policies like legalization of marijuana. This may be a little bit out of step with her conservative voting record. But Arrington was, I thought, an effective speaker. She could command the room. But sort of when you look deeper at some of her answers, you know, she was, you know, definitely singing from the Donald J. Trump hymnal or playbook, whichever metaphor you like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Since she is endorsed by him, backed by him. And, you know, I think Gibbs, one thing that really stood out to me, too, is that, you know, maybe they're trying to get each other off their game. I think both women managed to kind of stay in their lane and keep their own energy and cool in their own ways. It seemed like it did get heated towards the end there. And one thing really stood out to me was kind of going back to the debate from the State House, talking about the 2017 gas tax debate, which, you know, a lot of Republicans took issue with, you know, talking about it being like the biggest tax increase in the state's history, things like that. And Mace just really hammering Katie on that. And it seemed like, you know, you can really kind of draw some conclusions from that, and how that she could actually pinpoint something besides Arrington saying, oh, we can blame Nancy for all these problems, whereas, you know, Nancy was actually picking one and really drilling down on it.
Yeah, I mean, Nancy Mace is like, look, I'm the only conservative on the stage. I'm going to keep your taxes low. Katie Arrington supported the biggest tax increase in history. So I thought she was really effective on that. And then Nancy Mace, to me, was also really strong when she said, look, I've beat a Democrat. I can beat a Democrat again. You didn't beat a Democrat. And so I'm a better candidate for this district. And so I'm so fascinated by this race, because it's races like this that are ultimately going to decide whether it's going to be the Democrats in control in the House or the Republicans in control of the House. So obviously these are playing out around the country. Mm-hmm. But, you know, this will be type of race that if a Republican can win a race like this, they've got a pretty good chance of electing a Republican speaker. If not, then it's a chance for the Democrats to hold on. And so, you know, it's just really interesting to see that playing out right in our backyard, right here in South Carolina.
Yeah, we got to get to the primary first, June 14th, but then we'll definitely see what happens in the general. But Gibbs, really wrapping up on this debate before we move on to other topics, do you think there was a clear winner, or do you think in the eyes of their followers, they were both the winners?
I think they were both the winners. I mean, Arrington got in the jabs and sort of, you know, got in the one-liners that I think will make her supporters very, very happy. You know, for the Mace folks, I mean, they like her fiscal conservatism, but they like her willingness to reach across the aisle and think she's just a great fit for SC1. And so I think they both probably had folks that felt like they did well. So I don't think there was a real clear winner, but it definitely is going to give the Democrats have already started to run ads, you know, compiling together some of the parts of the debate. And so it's definitely given, you know, a lot of room for criticism from folks who didn't like what they heard on stage live. On Monday night.
Mm-hmm. And then we saw on Tuesday former President Donald Trump reiterating his support for Katie Arrington on a video on Twitter, a really short one, but just really kind of, you know, boosting her support. So I'm guessing really taking out all the stops now as we get in the final stretch here. But I want to talk to you about Dr. Annie Andrews, that Charleston pediatrician, who's the only Democrat on the ticket. So she's advanced to go, essentially. She'll be there in November facing off whoever wins this June 14th primary. But how do you see Andrews right now? I know it's, you know, we're still in the primary season, but, you know, whoever wins this is going to face her. She's a political newcomer. What's your take on her at this point?
So she participated in the College of Charleston bully pulpit series. So I got to sit down with her for about an hour on stage and asked her some questions of my own. And then we went to audience questions. And I mean, you know, she's an extremely compelling candidate. I mean, she's, you know, somebody who works for MUSC. Like you said, is a pediatrician. She has a very evidence-based, science-based approach to her thinking, you know, which is, you know, very different than a lot of what's going on out in American politics right now, certainly on the right. And so I think that that's an interesting dynamic. She's, you know, very, I think, has a really good social media strategy. She's out, you know, all the time talking about, you know, she can weigh in. And then she's also done a lot of her own research and kind of, as I can tell, kind of what her expertise within the medical field is gun violence and, you know, children who, and particularly the impacts of guns on young people. And so, you know, obviously with what happened in Texas on Tuesday, you know, she can really speak to those issues. And so I think she's really an ideal candidate for the Democrats in a lot of ways. You know, ultimately, she's going to have to raise some money And it's just not a district that's setting up, even with redistricting, is slightly more Republican than it was when Joe Cunningham won in 2018 and lost to Nancy Mace in 2020. So that's an additional battle that she's going to have to overcome. But, you know, she's able to not spend money, keep her powder dry, and, you know, gear up for whoever she goes up against, Mace or Arrington, in November.
And Gibbs, this whole primary is really just based off of the issues surrounding Republicans and their allegiance to Donald Trump, specifically supporting his false claims that the election was stolen in 2020, then also how they reacted to January 6th. You know, we saw Nancy Mace be very critical of the president for January 6th. We saw Tom Rice in the 7th Congressional District vote for impeachment of the president for inciting insurrection. So how do you see all that playing into these primaries, maybe here and elsewhere, when it comes to just the role the Stop the Steal plays?
It's a referendum on Trump and kind of where Republican voters in South Carolina are on this rhetoric right now. And, you know, when you see, you know, in a place like Alabama, you know, Trump may still have a good bit of sway. What we saw in our neighboring state of Georgia, though, is that, you know, the Trump-backed candidates didn't do as well. I mean, you know, somebody who studies the South and thinks about South Carolina kind of in the context of a larger region, I think we're probably a little closer to Georgia than Alabama, but we're probably somewhere in the middle. And so that's what I really am curious to see. You know, I'm curious to see how it plays out statewide. We'll see that with the governor's race, but also how it plays out in the first congressional district. And again, I think Mace is a stronger general election candidate for the Republicans for this particular district. Katie Arrington obviously disagrees with me, and she talked about that on stage. But, you know, it's going to really be interesting to see how much sort of the Stop the Steal, you know, not necessarily as critical of January 6th, you know, if that's going to win out among South Carolina's Republican voters here in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, because Trump has had a pretty good track record when it comes to the federal candidates he's endorsed. And talk about House members, and that's, you know, Russell Fry in the 7th, Katie Arrington, even, you know, William Timmons up in the 4th Congressional District, too. So we'll see how that plays out if it maintains that track record. But, yeah, anything else you gleaned from that, the primaries over there in Georgia with Brian Kemp blowing out David Perdue, and then also the Secretary of State's race, which is also something to watch?
Yeah, just so, you know, just really – I mean, Georgia is a different state. Georgia has two Democrats in the Senate right now, in the U.S. Senate representing that state. But yeah, just that how, you know, the Trump-backed candidates, you know, not only, you know, I figured it would be a little bit closer. I was surprised that Kemp did as well as he did, that the Secretary of State did as well as he did. And so, yeah, I mean, I think Georgia has always been a state that is very business oriented. Atlanta has, you know, tons of commerce and many companies, and they always tend to focus on, okay, what's good for business. And it seems like Kemp was able to, you know, really kind of, you know, make a better case to Georgia Republicans and sort of breaking away from the president in a way that, you know, I didn't necessarily anticipate. And it could be a sign for what we're going to see in South Carolina a little bit as well.
And Gibbs, just to kind of start wrapping up here, I want to talk about the Winthrop poll that came out this week from your good colleague, Scott Huffman, up there at Winthrop University, political science professor and the poll director there. And one of the big findings from his poll was that the general population that he polled found that 47% of respondents said the 2020 presidential election was fair, 45% said it wasn't. Kind of going back to what we were talking about here about stopping the steal. What do you see for the future of our country, our state, when you start seeing numbers like that and people really believing that the 2020 election wasn't fair?
It makes me really worried. I mean, you have to have, you know, faith in the election system. And when people start to question that, and obviously when, you know, it's like sports or anything else, if, you know, when your team loses, you're always going to blame it on the refs or the umpires or the system. You know, it sort of becomes, you know, sort of integrity in the system and faith and belief in the system is lost. And so those numbers were concerning to me. And obviously, you know, there are certain, you know, no one's questioning. Republicans aren't questioning when Republicans won. They're questioning when it was really, really close or when Democrats won. Is our election system perfect? Of course it's not perfect. There's always ways for improvement, and both sides need to come together and make sure the right people are voting. But overall, when people, serious people, nonpartisan people, have studied it and looked at it, you know, there's very little evidence of widespread voter fraud. And there's really very little evidence, if any, that voter fraud is changing election outcomes. And so let's continue to figure out how to make it better. But, you know, South Carolina voters can feel confident that their vote counts and that there's not some kind of underlying a scheme to sort of have advance one party over the other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we just saw that voter election early voting bill and election integrity bill just get signed into law too. So early voting
will
start.
That's great. I was really happy.
May 31st. Yeah, and just really quick, Gibbs, just two more numbers there. We saw 55% of those polled approve of how Governor McMaster is doing his job. So I'm guessing that bodes well for him in an election year like this, as does Tim Scott, who still remains the most popular Republican in the state with 66% approval rating. And not too far behind was Nikki Haley too at 63%.
Yeah, Tim Scott's amazing. I always feel like Tim Scott and Nikki Haley are always neck and neck for most popular. Lindsey Graham makes enough Republicans mad that he sometimes is a little bit behind them. But yeah, I mean, McMaster, he's an incumbent. He's, you know, done well in previous elections. He's not facing, you know, he's going to be able to not, he's not, you know, having to spend a lot of money to beat off a challenge in the primary. And so for all those reasons, you know, he's certainly the favorite. You know, we have Democratic governors. There's a Democratic governor in Kentucky, Democratic governor in Louisiana, Democratic governor in North Carolina. Democrats can win in the South, but it's been an awful long time in South Carolina. So I think, you know, certainly McMaster has to feel pretty good about his chances in November.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that 10% margin when he won the last time. So a lot to be made up there for Democrats this fall. But thank you, Gibbs Knotts. He's the Dean of the School of Humanities and Social Sciences at the College of Charleston. And he's going to be joining me and Scott Huffman on primary night, June 14th at 8 p.m. on ETV. We'll have live analysis and coverage from around the state. So again, thank you, Gibbs.
Thanks, Gavin.
Join me now to discuss the summer tourism season is Duane Parrish. He's director of the Department of Parks, Recreation, and Tourism in South Carolina. Duane, thanks for coming back.
Thank you, Gavin. Glad to be here.
So, Duane, let's talk about the tourism industry in South Carolina. It's one of our biggest ones in the state. How are things going? Tell us how things have been going so far since the recovery, since the pandemic, and now that we're about to kick off Memorial Day weekend, which is obviously the kickoff for summer.
Things are going very well. If you had asked me a year ago, they're much better than I expected. 2021, while sort of up and down a little bit, finished very, very strong. Outdoor recreation became sort of the preferred engagement for people traveling. That's still the case today. And that includes everything from golf to canoeing to fishing to boating to kayaking to camping to hiking. And we are a state sort of known for those things. So that's been very, very popular. 2022 has started out, you know, I've learned not to try to predict too much, but could be a record year for us. You know, as bad as 2020 was, 2022 looks the other way.
Gotcha. And then when we're looking at the revenues, I mean, how did last year shape up? And do you think kind of what you're saying, I don't want to predict anything, but maybe what you're looking at in terms of spring break, maybe early bookings for summer, how things are looking right now?
Things look very good for the summer. You know, the AAA has even said that, you know, it's maybe the best Memorial Day weekend ever. For people traveling. I certainly believe that, particularly in the South. Our gas prices are still, while high, still low compared to some other parts of the country. I do believe the $5 mark may cause some pause with people, but not stop travel. You know, we haven't been above $5 in the Southeast, really. But so far, it really has not slowed it down at all. Future reservations look very good for both Memorial Day weekend and throughout the summer. I expect that to continue, at least for the next 3 to 6 months. Through the spring and early fall, 2022 should be a record year for tourism, barring some unforeseen circumstance. Now, you never know what's out there, whether it be COVID or a hurricane or the likes, but so far, so good. Knock on wood.
It's encouraging to hear. How was our spring break, Duane, looking back? Can you maybe make any assumptions based on what we saw this year?
Yeah, very strong. Hotel occupancy was sort of mirrored 2019 statewide, even stronger on the coast. What's changed dramatically is hotel room rates are up significantly from spring of 2019. Mm-hmm. Hotels have, you know, demand has been very strong, and, you know, we're in a, you know, it is demand. When demand's strong, the rates are going to go up, and that's what's happened. And, of course, now you have gas prices and inflation and other things have gone up. But certainly expect to spend more, but you're going to have a great time, because if you've been cooped up for a year, it's a great time to get out and enjoy some of what South Carolina has to offer.
Mm-hmm. And the hospitality industry itself, workers, that's really strongly rebounded as well from what you're seeing?
It has rebounded some. You know, still our biggest challenge. We're still not quite at the employment we had prior to COVID, but getting closer. Wages have gone up about 23% in the hospitality and leisure category. Mm-hmm. Things like that, you know, making people feel more valued. We've done some workforce housing in places along the coast in our industry. Some new things being tried, I think, that are helping the employment situation, but it's a complicated issue, and it will take some complex resolutions to fix it.
So, Duane, you're saying things are pretty encouraging right now, especially with the economy, with inflation going the way it is. Gas prices are averaging about $4.27 a gallon right now in the state. Like you said, one of the lower prices in the Southeast. How does that affect some of these, you know, these drive-in markets that you guys always talk about and tout about when it comes to affecting tourism here?
You know, it actually helps. Airline prices have typically followed because the jet fuel price goes up as well, and that's the case here. Fortunately for South Carolina, about 80% of the people drive into the state. And so we're typically what's called a drive market state, and we market outside. We've expanded that market. It used to be 350-mile radius. Now it goes out about 700 miles. Oh. We market out even all the way up into the Northeast and the Midwest for the drive market, particularly interstate travel. You know, I-77 goes all the way up into the Ohio and in the Midwest, and that helps us as a state. For that drive market. You know, Myrtle Beach, Charleston, Hilton Head, all strong brands that are well-known in the Midwest and in the Northeast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Duane, I was going to ask you, do you guys have an ideal profile of a visitor to our state? Have we expanded that profile? Have we seen more folks from the Northeast, like New York, New Jersey, especially since the pandemic? Maybe they got turned on to the state because of, you know, looser restrictions down here?
Well, yeah, exactly. They were exposed early. Two things have happened. We've always had a high profile, I think, with the Midwest and the Northeast. What's happened is they visit here more frequently now because of, particularly when COVID started, and then a lot of them realized that they could live and work here, and so a lot have bought real estate. And so real estate obviously is very strong, particularly along the coast. But when you can work from home, but I always tell people they didn't buy real estate without becoming a visitor first. Mm-hmm. And so they visited, had a great experience, learned, said, hey, I want to live here, work here, play here. And that's a lot of what's happened to us. And we've been, you know, which is why we've been the second highest migration in state in the United States.
Mm-hmm. And when we look at other travel forms of travel, I know you're talking about a lot of drive-in markets. How have the, you know, air traffic, how has that rebounded, especially international air traffic now?
Air traffic is in South Carolina is almost at the same level it was pre-COVID. And in some cases, Myrtle Beach and Charleston, there are actually more direct flights to cities than there were pre-COVID. Mm-hmm. You know, airlines realize they move planes to where people will fly. When business travel was still down, they moved to leisure markets like Charleston and Myrtle Beach. And that's still the still the case today. And then we have new airlines like Breeze Airways, which has introduced, I think, almost 10 cities directly from Charleston, which has helped add to the capacity as well as the destinations.
Mm-hmm. Duane, looking more towards what we have here in the state, the outdoors especially, state parks really took off during the pandemic. I want to ask you about just how you guys are keeping up with the popularity of these state parks. What's maybe in the budget? What do you expect to see to improve these conditions because they have become so popular?
They have. As soon as we reopened in May of 2020, we had people waiting at the gates, and that's still the case today. State parks have been extremely busy, very popular. We had been spending the last several years catching up on deferred maintenance, and that's still the case today. We also have 5 new parks coming in the next couple of years, which will help with some of the capacity. They're spread out throughout the state, but really excited about state parks. They've become, as I mentioned earlier, a preferred engagement for a lot of travelers. We have a lot to offer in state park.
Mm-hmm. And then, of course, like you're saying, 5 new state parks. That's pretty exciting to add to the repertoire.
Yeah, very much so. It is. We are fortunate to get, we have one on Lake Murray in the middle of the state. We have one Misty Lake, which is up in the Aiken area. Ramsey Grove, which is down in the Georgetown area. And we have May Forest, which is a former convent that overlooks the Charleston Harbor. And then we have the Black River Project, which is actually a series of 7 different sites along the Black River that are connected by water, which is a little bit new for us. That's a state park unlike any other we have today, but really excited about getting that open next year. And if you're into kayaking and paddling into a special place along the river, that's a great place to go.
Very exciting news to hear. And of course, you know, you guys had some big priorities from the pandemic as well in terms of marketing grants for a lot of these different places throughout the state, not necessarily the big cities, but the smaller cities too. I think some of those have been recently awarded. What are you guys hoping to do with those grants to try and drive traffic to smaller markets in the state?
Well, when this federal government, you know, first the CARES Act and then the ARPA funds that are in place now, the state was gracious enough to allow us, legislature and the governor's office, to spend $20 million. That spread was spread throughout the state and kind of gave us a leg up on our surrounding states. And we certainly did well, particularly with the outdoor engagement that I mentioned a moment ago. You know, now the other states have those funds, too. And so the marketing is imperative that we maintain, at least maintain our fair share, if not increase it. But we'll certainly put that in place. With today's digital world, we can, you know, we can make moves and be very nimble and change our target or our message on the fly almost. And in just different markets that we haven't been to before. And I'll give you one quick example. Texas, never marketed really there before. We did some of that with some of the extra funds. And it wasn't a lot large percent of the population, but Texas has a lot of people. So that was a big number for us. Texans love South Carolina. So we're going to continue to do that.
Exciting things on the horizon there for parks and, of course, tourism in the state. That's Duane Parrish. He's Director of State Parks, Recreation, and Tourism here in South Carolina. Thanks, Duane.
Thank you, Gavin.
To stay up to date with the latest news throughout the week, check out the South Carolina Lead. It's a podcast that I host on Tuesdays and Saturdays that you can find on southcarolinapublicradio.org or wherever you find podcasts. For South Carolina ETV, I'm Gavin Jackson. Be well, South Carolina.